Manawale Riding Center, making an impact by putting a smile on a child's heart, mind, and spirit. Good evening. My name is Patty Silva, and I represent Manawale Riding Center. We are a branch club of Ko'olaupoko Lions Club. We're also a therapeutic horseback riding center located at Da Ranch in Waimanalo. We are also a member center of the Professional Association of Therapeutic Horsemanship International, more commonly called PATH International. However, we were also known as NARA, which was North American Riding for the Handicapped, but we are now an international organization, so NARA did not fit anymore. Before I get started, I'd like to also introduce some of our board members that are here with us this evening. We have Ben Char Jr., who is the president of Manawale Riding Center. Stand up, Ben. We have Vice President Wayne Silva. We have Anna Char, who is secretary. We also took the liberty of bringing Nicole with us, who's one of our junior volunteers. And I am the board secretary, Susie, the board treasurer, and a PATH International certified riding instructor. A horseback riding center that would enable children, youth, and adults with disabilities the ability to interact with large animals in a manner that would enhance their quality of life, build self-esteem, and would help teach basic life skills was the lifelong dream of Ben Char Jr., the founder of Manawale Riding Center. He's been doing this by word of mouth for many, many years. However, Manawale Riding Center was then created in 2001. We are made up entirely of volunteers, and there is no paid staff. Our volunteers are made up of horse owners, physical therapist assistants, an occupational therapist, a speech therapist, retired nurse, retired teacher, public health educator, trauma center technician, a veterinarian technician, military, and just lots of folks wanting to help develop a relationship with horses and helping physically and mentally challenged children, youth, and adults. We also have junior volunteers that assist in cleaning stalls, grooming our program horses, and help the children with the different activities. I almost forgot, the most important volunteers in our entire program are our horses. So we have, the first one is Lizzie. She's more affectionately called Lazy Lizzie. We have Ekahi, who thinks she's number one, and she is in our hearts. We have Poo, Ka'ulani, Lightning, who is a young gelding in training, Sally, who is our Batangas pony, and Diamond, a miniature horse. And our most popular props are Miss Woodette and Mr. Woody. The mission of Manawale is to educate and enrich our island communities through structured programs and services designed to foster a mutual and beneficial relationship between people and animals. The expected benefits from such animal-assisted therapy include increased self-confidence, improved judgment, reasoning skills, enhanced physical fitness and coordination, and enhanced sensory awareness and increased trust and empathy with people and animals. At Manawale Riding Center, we have created learning stations that include, but not limited to, stretching and balancing exercises on plastic drums, balance beam exercises, mounting bareback pads, Miss Woodette, and saddles, Mr. Woody. They are adhered to a stationary horizontal telephone poles, our grooming of our pony and miniature horse, and of course, horseback riding. All of these stations are very flexible and designed to be adapted to the rider's ability or disability. However, before any of these activities begin, there's always a safety session. Safety cannot be stressed enough. Children are made to understand the safety rules at Manawale. Volunteers are always on the lookout for a potential safety hazard, and it is corrected immediately. In addition to our 10 horses and 2 ponies, there are 3 cats, 3 dogs, 1 rabbit, 1 goat, 1 cow, 11 white Chinese chickens that have white fluffy feathers and black skin and black bones, 4 tabletop chickens that keep multiplying worse than rabbits, let me tell you that, 1 pot-bellied pig, 1 feral pig, 80 racing pigeons, 1 mongoose that watched all of our little chicks grow and didn't touch a one, and a couple tackroom mice. All of these animals play an integral part in our therapeutic riding center. At this time, I'd like to share a video with you that was created by one of the dads of our clients. He does this every year for us for our annual fundraiser. This year's video, he divided into 3 sections, old and new. So you'll see some of our original, what we look like several years ago, and you'll see what we currently look like. It is also with including our clients, our volunteers, and our volunteers giving back to our community in Waimanalo. So I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you. True.
kind of neat. That video actually kind of goes over our whole 12 years of doing this. If you'll notice that we started out with an uncovered arena, and then we were very, very blessed to get a grant from the Castle Foundation as well as Lions International. It was a matching grant, and we were able to put in a covered arena. So we're very, very blessed. I think our dermatologist loved us before the covered arena. We all went a lot, so if you can see our skin. But some of those children that you saw in the video are still with us. And it's just absolutely incredible to see how they have grown and how they've improved. And, you know, therapeutic riding is like eating an elephant. And how does it happen? One tiny little bite at a time. You're not going to swallow this whole elephant at one crack. You're going to do it small. So the things that you see, the improvements in these children, happen over time. So it just doesn't happen by coming one time to ride a horse. It happens over, you know, over time. The horse's gait, and the reason for this primarily is the horse's gait replicates and duplicates a human gait. So every muscle that I am using by just walking in front of you like this is being exercised if I sit on a horse or anyone sits on a horse and let the horse walk and you just sit there. So these children that have, and adults that have mobility issues, this is phenomenal. I mean, they cannot go anywhere and get out of their wheelchair and start walking like this. It just doesn't happen. They don't get that kind of exercise. And I don't know if you picked up that in the video that you saw a couple children riding backwards. Okay, the backwards riding is the same thing. You cannot go to any clinic. No clinical setting is going to give you a piece of equipment that is going to enable a person who is wheelchair bound to be able to walk backwards. It just doesn't happen. But you turn them around, and our game, we play a game going around the world. So we, on our bareback pad, with our exercises, we go around the world. And we get them on the horse, we do the same thing. Oh, remember, we got to go around the world, everybody. So, and you have to make a complete circle around the horse. So what that does is that now we turn them backwards, and they're exercising all these posterior muscles back here that would never, ever have an opportunity to be exercised if they were just going to a clinic. But you know, it's perhaps not very comfortable for them, so to make it better, what we do is that we play ball, we throw balls at them, we have colored cones, we have numbers, we make them pick up little round rings, put them on a, you know, and just play all kinds of stuff. They have no idea they're being stretched to the limit. But guess what? It's all good. It's really all good. Okay, so in our program, we currently have knee glasses. We currently have 31 clients on a weekly basis. Our clients range in age from 2.5 to 72. They come from all over the island. These clients are affected with autism, mild to very, very severe. We have cerebral palsy. I have to just interject one fast little quick thing. With cerebral palsy, you know, it's like there's a short circuit in the brain. And what happens with these children is that some of them does they end up with seizures, their muscles don't do what they want them to do. The legs and the arms don't do what they're supposed to do when they're supposed to do it. We had I just can't explain it. I mean, it's just hard to explain. We've had this little boy that was with us. The family is military. He was with us for 3 or 4 years when they were here the first time. They moved to Texas. They came back. This little guy now is, I believe, about 10. He comes every Wednesday afternoon. His mom came Wednesday and said, oh, by the way, he took 4 steps yesterday at home. And we said, 4? He said, yes. He took one and balance, balance, balance. And then he took another one and balance, balance, balance. And then he took another one. He did that 4 times yesterday. I said, wow, isn't that neat? I said, could you show me how you did that? And the mom says, oh, well, show Auntie Patty. He goes, I can't do that. I said, oh, please, but I wasn't there at home yesterday. Could you show me? I couldn't believe it. We were in tears. This young man took 9 steps. The first 2 were balance, 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 and the last few steps, they were just like regular walking. It was just like, could you believe that? It was just incredible. And then he wanted to make sure everybody saw him, and he kept making sure, did you count that? Oh, yes, yes, yes. He was up to almost 20 steps by the time he left. It was just like incredible. Okay, now getting back to the kind of people we service. Okay, we have cerebral palsy, we have Down syndrome, we have Rett syndrome, ADHD, learning delays, paralysis, severe brain damage as a result of near drowning. We have one little girl that was a drowning victim, if you could call her that, and they were ready to remove the life support on her, and she started to breathe. And this little girl is now able, I buddy ride with her, she's able to make two complete circles in our round covered arena, holding her head upright by herself. It's just incredible, just incredible. And we also have our 72-year-old gentleman is a stroke victim, so he's just incredible too. He says it's riding a horse to him is like he has 100 people massaging him all at the same time. No. Go figure that one. I thought, okay, that's kind of neat. In addition, we have special programs set up with schools, such as our work and ride program, as you can see down here. This is with our Farrington High School, our work and ride program. The year that they did this, needless to say, they did not ride too much. They were not too well behaved. So we had to get another project for them, and we challenged them to get on the internet and build us and design a sensory trail for us. And this is the result. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that in a little bit. And then we have Variety Schools. They have a summer program with autistic children from Osaka, Japan. And that was quite interesting. They came for 3 years in a row. And it seems like, unfortunately, in Japan, they are very, very modern with everything. However, their children with disabilities are put in back rooms. So I don't know if you remember a young girl that was in riding our special chair, this Oriental girl, and she's kind of leaning back. That young lady is from, she's a Japanese national. When she was born, the doctors told her mother to just go ahead and get a comfortable bed and put her in a bed, build a bedroom in the back of their house and just leave her there. Can you imagine? How'd you feel, you know? But it's just unfortunate. So this is a pilot program that the Variety School did with autistic children from Japan, and it was just really, really phenomenal. These parents have come back years after on their own to participate. So that was really neat. And in addition, we hosted 24 high school young ladies from the tsunami-ravaged Sendai. Do you remember in the video all those young ladies that had the blue pants on? They were from Sendai. And when they came as so terribly traumatized as a result of the tsunami and the earthquake, and their school had been demolished. So they were allowed to come to Hawaii to finish their school year. And because they were so traumatized, and one of the other teachers from Farrington that we had dealt with, she felt that the animals would be very, very healing for these young ladies. So they came, and these young ladies, wanted them to work to begin with. So the deal was they had to come and clean stalls. Well, this evidently is a very affluent area. These young ladies did not know how to hold a broom. They didn't know how to, and then the smell of the horse poop is just like. But, you know, after they came, they were scheduled to come 3 times, and after they did, they were so impressed that people in Hawaii from our center came to help them. Every day they came, we had almost 20 people that volunteered to come and help them. So what they opted to do, what they asked to do, is that when they were through, they asked if they could come back and volunteer with us, for us. And it was, by the time they got through, they cleaned the best stalls. I'd love to have those girls come back any day. They're really, really great. But that was quite very, very nice. We also host an annual picnic for the blind participants of Ho'opono. So I believe you saw some of them coming off the bus. And just last week, we had another, it was our annual picnic. And some of our ladies here came to join us and help. So that was really, really nice. In addition, we also host the Lions International Youth Camp. And these are youngsters 16 to, I think, 20 years of age from around the world that come. They are able-bodied riders, but they come from all over the world. And they come and spend they do lots of things. I think they're here for almost 3 weeks. And they come and spend an afternoon with us, and that's really kind of fun. So we enjoy doing that, too. So this time, I'd like to call your attention to some of the goodies that we brought with us tonight. So first of all, this is our therapeutic saddle. So I have Nicole, AKA Vanna. Okay, Vanna. Okay, so this is our therapeutic saddle. It was designed by a gentleman in Colorado who has a daughter with cerebral palsy. And the reason he designed it the way he did is because, you know, lots of cerebral palsy children have the scissoring. You know, they just really scissor when they walk. So by having a bar like this, they're able to hold in a neutral position, open up their lungs, breathe easy, and just get away from that tightness. This bar also slides out. Okay, you can slide that out. So if we need to, depending on their ability, if they're really, really tight and we're not able to get their legs to open up to go over the top of the horse, we're able to take this bar out, get them on the horse, either with our lift or physically carry them on if they're small enough, or if they're able to lift their legs to get up and go up and over, the right leg up and over, we will do that. But if that's really hard, we're able to take that bar out and put it back. The other thing that's really interesting about this is that that bar does not go all the way through. It only comes up and goes in a little bit, so there's a lot of flexibility in the top of that. Want to show them? Yeah, see, there's a lot of flexibility in that, and the reason for that is to work on balance. So they're able to move it around. So you want them to work on their core strength by sitting up straight. So we work on posture a lot. So what this enables them to do that. So that's really kind of neat. We have another special seat we didn't bring with us this evening, but I think you saw it in our video. A couple of the fellows that we bring up on our lift and we put them into that chair. This chair is able to slide right into the back of the sleeve right here. So now it becomes a very versatile saddle. So we take this out, slide the seat in the back, and now we have someone who would not normally be able to sit up on their own be able to ride. So that makes it kind of neat. These are also peacock safety stirrups that we use throughout our program. And the reason for that is that should heaven forbid that there's ever a need to get them off very, very quickly, that this rubber band will just flip off and they're free and clear of the saddle, of the stirrups that are on the saddle. Okay, good. Okay, and the next thing we have here are what they call ladder reins. So our stroke victim uses these. He's only got one good hand, one good arm. So what happens is that he'll put his weak hand in one of the rungs here. His good hand becomes his steering. So as he's turning the horse, the weak hand is going along for the ride, getting some exercise. So he's moving this along, but he's latched on to one of the rungs here, and so therefore it moves along with it. Okay. And then we also have our hackamore. And we use the hackamore instead of a bit. You know, most of the times you see horses with bits in their mouth and the reins and things. We use a hackamore, and the reason for that is that a lot of our children have these real floppy hands, and they think they want to go giddy up, and the poor horses are going, yikes. So we use the hackamore to protect the animals, but then we also use rainbow reins. So if we ask the children or our clients to shorten your reins, choke up on your reins, they have not a clue what we're saying. So, but if you tell them, move your hands from the red to the yellow, they know colors. So that makes it a lot easier for them to participate and to follow the instructions. Okay, and this is everyone has to wear a safety helmet. And these are ASTM SCI certified helmets. They need to be a certain type. We cannot allow anyone to come in with a bike helmet or any kind of helmet. They have to use our type of helmets. We provide them for the children and we spray them after each use so we don't share goodies. Okay, and then we usually use a rubber pad underneath all of our saddles. And usually what we do is that we wash these after every use because, you know, just like you wouldn't want to use somebody else's hairbrush. So we just kind of share these and then brush them off. And then this is our vest. So I think you saw some of that in some of our video that we use this on some of our children. We have some of our clients that have some real tactile issues, you know, don't touch me kind of thing. Don't, you know, some of these autistic children have some really unusual things that they just don't want you to touch them. Like we had one little fella today, as a matter of fact. I don't know if you were walking with him. He kept pushing the hand away. He goes, don't touch me.
Well, you know, we got to hold you on the horse, fella. Okay, we got to make sure you're safe. So I said, okay, fine. We'll just, you better hold on then, and you better be balanced because we're not holding you. And he did fine. You know, just like, don't touch me. Okay, and then we have, and then this is one of our surcingles. Okay, it is just, it's used a lot for, perhaps for training, for vaulting. However, we use it for some of our children that just have some other issues that this little bar here might be a little bit too flexible for them. So we started to use this. We put some stirrups on it. It's really not the way it should be used, but you know, in the therapeutic riding world, you have to get very creative to make things work for you, because not you just don't go to a store or find a book and it's going to be there. You've got to, and if it works today, it may not work tomorrow. So, and if it worked yesterday, it may not work today. So everything is different, and you have to be ready to change immediately and just work with what comes. We also have a couple of our clients that with this surcingle do a really, really basic vaulting. And now vaulting is the kind of thing where you'll see them in the movies or in the shows and stuff where they run alongside the horse and they'll jump up on top of it and stand up and do all kinds of tricks. Well, we don't do that. But we do have some of our children that, some of our artistic children especially, that feel that they just need to have something more, you know, and just riding on a horse, or, and we trot with some of them, but they just want something more exciting. So what we'll do is that we'll put them with this surcingle and we'll have them sit like a frog. We'll have them get up on their knees, and before you know it, we'll get them to stand up. Of course, they need to not be too tall. And thank goodness Ben is 6'3", so he's around a lot and holding these children. But it's amazing, though, that these children have got balance. And it's just absolutely incredible for their self-esteem to be walking on a horse, hands out and walking straight up, you know, just looking straight up there. And that's really, really kind of neat. So we use that for a little bit of that. And then, and then we have these little things here, these other little goodies. Put these down on the ground when it said children. And these are instructions they have to follow to go, whoa, stop, slow. We've got all kinds of other little toys that we play with. We've got colored cones. We put numbers on them. They have to find the numbers. They have to add numbers to get to another number. And just really, I mean, you just do all kinds of really fun things for them. In the meantime, they're still being exercised. Okay, so I don't know. Are there any questions? I will. I'd be delighted. Okay, so let me just start here. Okay, what happened is that, first of all, we had this program with Farrington High School. It was a work and ride program. And I asked the students to go design a sensory trail. And they said, what is that? I said, you go check it out. You get on the internet, you go figure out what it is. Well, they called me back a couple days later and they said, Miss Auntie, how much space do we have? I said, I don't know, we'll go check. So we went and we measured it out, and they had 70 feet by 110. They came back the following week, and they said, oh, here. And they brought out all this butcher paper with all this stuff on it, and we had, I thought, oh, wow, that's pretty good. So the teacher says, do you have any idea? Do you have a draftsman that could help us put this to scale? I said, no. I said, let me check. So I was able to find an architect who had his office in their school district, and what he did is that he went to their school, spent a couple hours with them, and he taught them how to take their design and put it into the space that was allocated. So after we did that, so we got that going. And then all of a sudden, I got a call from the Pacific Institute National Honor Society counselor asking, oh, we need 20 hours community service. Do you have a project? I go, ha, I sure do. I have an absolute wonderful project. So what we did with this project is that we had a reversal of roles. So we had Farrington High School students that were unfortunately not the best little students in the whole school, that they became our architects, and the Mid-Pacific Institute students, honor students, became the laborers. So in all fairness to the Mid-Pacific Institute students, we were able to get a small construction company that came in to teach these kids how to hold a shovel, dig a hole, mix cement, put these, if you saw the pictures in our video, okay, all the kids with the shovels were the National Honor Society students. The little guy in black with the can of spray paint that was not doing graffiti, but he was making marks on the ground to show these brilliant kids where all of these goodies should go, he wants to be an architect now. Okay, so what we start off with over here is that they come into our trail, and so they come into the two mailboxes. There are two mailboxes. Everything that we have in our sensory trail is horse high. So this one might be a little bit better here. And you can come and look at that one later, but this is one of our children actually going through the trail. So they ride up to the first mailbox, and what we have them do as well is that a lot of our autistic children have a real issue with their right brain or left brain. So what happens is that they have a very difficult time crossing over into the other hemisphere of their brain. So when they ride up to our first mailbox, which is on the right side of the horse, we have them reach in and open up the mailbox with the left hand, crossing over their midline, going into an unfamiliar area. Okay, so they're able to find the little goodies. There's all kinds of rubber ducks and all kinds of animals in there. So they take one out, and then they close the mailbox, and then they ride to the second mailbox, changing hands now, and now they're crossing over, and now the mailbox is on the left side of the horse. So they're opening up that mailbox with the right hand, putting their little rubber animal, whatever it is, and putting it in there and closing the mailbox. Then from there, they ride down to this area here. And this is a little box that has balls in it. So they ride up with their right hand, reach into the box with their balls, take another couple steps, and then they have to throw their ball through the hula hoop. We try to get someone who's got good catching ability, which is not myself, but we get them to stand here and the children will try to throw. So we've got different types of balls. We've got actually foam rubber balls. We've got a very heavy rubber ball that has holes in it because some of our children just can't hold things. They can stick their fingers through it, but it's incredible because sometimes they stick their fingers through and it becomes their ball. Can't get it out. Fingers lock. So then we have a really light one as well. So they grab a ball, take it through here. These telephone poles over here. What we try to do is that we try to get the children to, if they're able to do this, stand up in their stirrups, get their butt off the saddle, and we call it, it's a two-point. It's called two-point. So every time they come up to a telephone pole, they have got to go two-point and go over it. The other part of this sensory trail, and I think you could probably see it maybe better in this other one here, there are all different footings. See, initially sensory trails were designed for blind folks, blind children. So as you come into the sensory trail, we start out with sand, so you have a different sound. And then from sand, you go into gravel, so you have this ksh, 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 ksh. And then we have wood chips, and then we've got more gravel, we've got dirt. And then just before they get into this bridge over here, it's rubber dust. So it's all ground up tires. So it's very thick and quiet and soft. So as a horse walks in there, the horse kind of sinks and it's quiet. And then from the quiet, they hit the bridge. So the bridge, now what they did, what our little construction company did, is that they dug out underneath there. So there's plywood on top of there. So when they go over this, it actually is hollow. And it makes this on top of, on that wood. So from there, they come off and then they go into the wood chips. And then they come out and then we've got, as they're coming, and then these are little swimming noodles, you know, the ones that you swim with. We've cut them in half, and what happens is that they go through and the cuts all over the horses. They pick out the color that they want to have hit their heads. So we try to maneuver the horse around there to get through there, and then they come around, and then these are wind chimes made out of copper pipe. So the children are encouraged to play the chimes, make the music. This little one is so fast, we've got to hold hands. She's really, really fast. She has ripped out more of our noodles, more of our chimes. So if you'll notice, they're doing the chimes, but they're holding her hands. So just kind of like, shh, shh. So that one does that. But she just has a great time in there. And then as they come off the bridge, there's a lot of wood chips. And then they zigzag. The children are encouraged to pick up the reins again and steer the horse through the maze coming out of there. And then there's a little mound. This is a little hill. So what happens is if the horses come up, we try to stop them at the top, let the children look around, and then the horses know that, hey, that's downhill, that's fun. So they kind of go down a little faster. So that kind of makes it fun. So That's that one, and then got over there. Yeah, so what you saw in our video was when it was first built. And with all of our flowers and everything, this is what it looks like today. So we're really very, very excited about that. But we're always looking for projects. We're always looking for more help. And so on behalf of Manawale Writing Center, I'd like to thank all of you for coming tonight and listening to us. And we're always, always looking for more volunteers. And we hope that maybe some of you would like to come and join us. So are there any questions? We brought a few brochures with us. I'm sorry, yes, sir.
I was just wondering about the types of breeds of the horse. Are they all the same type? I'm not too familiar with horses.
I'll defer that to Ben. We'll let Ben answer that question. He's asking about the breeds of the horses. Are they all the same?
No, there's quarter horses, and some of them are pot thoroughbreds, and some of them are poi, because we got them from people who probably can't feed them. Not all horses can do a program like this because it's the temperament there. So it's like us. We're all from different kinds of, whether we white, black, Chinese, or whatever. But it's the temperament. But they can learn. But not all of them are made for this type, because they got to be pretty much subtle, quiet, as much as possible. Thoroughbreds are known to be high-strung. Arabians are high-strung. But they, some of them still can't go through the program. It really depends. And the upbringing is one of them, yeah? You know, it depends how that horse was treated at the beginning. Now, if you get mistreated from when you're young, then, of course, when you get older, you're going to be one, you know? But, again, it's really on the discipline or the horse. The breeds, sometimes, yes. Thoroughbreds, sometimes, majority of the time, won't make a good. It really depends. But not everybody is the same like us. Not everybody is the same. And if you want to learn, you can, if you want to. When the kids come up our place, there's no such thing of no can, cannot. Okay, there's no vocabulary up my place. Everybody can. The only time you cannot is when you don't want to. That's bottom line. Everybody can learn. Everybody can get ahead. You just got to help. And everybody up all place, help each other, yeah? I started from not knowing nothing to where I'm at now. So everybody got to start someplace, right? Everybody got to take that first step. And the bottom line is, if everybody can help everybody, then everybody can move along. It's when you don't help and you have an attitude. And sometimes when the horse is that attitude, I'm the attitude adjuster. Because sometimes the animals, they realize on certain people, don't have, over here, gotta be porno, yeah? Because if you're inside, if you're afraid, that animal picks that up. Any animal picks that up. If over here, not porno, then there's no way you're going, the kind, I don't care what anybody teaches you. Because everybody, I can teach you all kind about horses, but I cannot teach you fear. Some people, easy to hide it. Some people cannot. Yeah, on the outside, you might think you hide that fear, but you bring on animal that's on test, you're going to see if that fear going to come out or not, yeah? So working with animals, it's a big difference too. Yes, the animals, not all animals is made for this program. And not because you got a paper expensive horse can do the program, you know? Like, we got a couple horses that got no papers. They're poor horses, but they're very good for the program. Most important thing for us is safety, yeah? Safety with our horses, safety with our volunteers, because we don't want nobody to get hurt, yeah? Especially us as humans, yeah? I can always buy another horse, but if you get hurt, you broke a leg, I really can't buy another thing. So safety, if anything is, gonna be a threat, everybody asks the next person, whoever can help, or eliminate that thing from happening, yeah?
Okay, oh, thank you very much. Yes?
How long has this program been running? How long have you guys have it all been?
We actually got our nonprofit status in the year 2000. We started with that. But actually in about 2002 is when we really started to do this. So it's been a little over 10 years. Yes?
Hi, thank you so much for coming. What does Manawale mean? Manawale
means giving from the heart, charitable.
Charitable.
Uh-huh.
Thanks.
Yay! Oh. No, that is there. See, there. Ironically, there are two therapeutic riding centers in Waimanalo, or there's two on Oahu, and they're both in Waimanalo. And the one that you're talking about across from Sherwoods is actually called Therapeutic Horsemanship of Hawai'i. They're at the polo field. No. We're up in the hill. We look down on them. No. We're actually on the back road. And we're off the main highway, and we're up on actually a coral shelf. It's a plateau, and we're on Hawaiian homestead land is what we're on. So we're up on the top there. You can come visit anytime. We have an annual fundraiser. Our fundraiser this year is going to be August 18th. It is from 12 to 7, and we need a ton of volunteers every year. So we'd love to have you all come and join us and help.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
I guess I have more of a personal question. What got you into doing this, and how long have you been participating in therapeutic riding?
Well, Ben and I went. Ben has been doing this for many, many years, just by word of mouth. And then what we decided to do is that we decided to put some form and rhyme or reason to what we were doing to learn more about this. So Ben and I went to, and then we discovered that there was this thing, this organization called North American Riding for the Handicapped. And then we started to do some checking, and we thought, you know, there's a lot of people on the mainland that are doing this, and there was nothing here in Hawaii. So Ben and I went to Tucson, Arizona, and to get certified, to learn more about this and to get certified. So we did that, and then it took us a while because we were not, I personally was not familiar with English type writing, and this is what this whole thing is, in English writing, and that was not so good. But actually though, so we've been doing this since I think about 2001, actually we started doing that. And it started out with Ben doing that, and we tried to put some semblance of order. And some of our first board members were actually educators. And they helped us write educational plans. And that's how we came up with educational stations to do this and all these different things. And so we started out with a model, an educational model, like the DOE does for their special ed students. And so from there, we just kind of went around. And we are truly not educators in the format that, you know, I'm not a teacher, I'm not a therapist, but we are all horse owners, and we are all very, very committed, and we certainly believe in what our animals can do for what they've done for us and what they can certainly do for our children. And so we just kind of love it. Yes. Oh, I thought you had your hand up. I'm sorry. Oh, okay, yes. Well, it took a while.
Now,
no, I went to Arizona. Okay, and I'll be really frank with you. I did not pass the first time. I did not pass the writing test. So I came back and I took English writing lessons because I figured that would be the way to learn how to do that. So I went to, at the time it was at Circle C on the back roads. So I went and I got some English writing lessons, and I was allowed to videotape my writing, and I submitted that, and then I finally passed. So that was actually in 2003, I guess, that I finally passed. But
3 years.
No, we went in 2001, and then we got busy with our program. So that I thought, you know, I really need to get certified. So then I went back for that and got the. But for now the requirements have changed. So before you can even start to qualify to go in for the final testing to be certified, you have to have at least 25 hours of instruction of someone with disabilities on horseback. You have to have a mentor that will follow you through all of your classes. You have to also, there's different tests that you have to take. There's what they call a CAT test, and you have to score a certain percentage on all of these tests. And they never had a lot of that stuff when Ben and I went to start off with, but now they've really changed the requirements. And I think Megan is gonna probably attest to some of that when she double checks on her requirements too. But then, and then you have to go, you have to attend this workshop, and then you have to attend the, then you have to go for the actual certification testing. And so that is, you have to have a lesson plan created, you have to actually execute the lesson, you have to have, and then you have your actual riding test itself. So that, it's quite a long process these days. It's usually at least a couple years now in order to get certified. It's well worth it though. Yes?
I was fortunate enough to be a part of this at one time, and I really respect and admire what you guys do. And I noticed that you guys are involved in the lion. Can mm-hmm. you tell us what that's about? Because I found it it's really cool how you guys just gather and you guys all come for that common cause, and it's all put towards this effort, you know, towards the ranch and towards the kids and everything. Can you tell us about that and how that worked into it? Because I know that played a big part in how you guys got your arena. And mm-hmm.
I would be very happy to. We are, Manawale Riding Center is the first, was the first branch club in the state of Hawaii as a Lions group. So Ko'olaupoko Lions Club is what you'd want to call maybe our mother club. And so what happened is that we had no idea anything about this Lions thing. Well, we did a presentation at Shriners, and some of the folks that were providing some of the dinner that night happened to be a group of friends, but they were all Lions, and they did this. So they asked us, how are you folks operating? You know, what are you doing? And so they were saying that, you know, their motto, the Lions' motto, is we serve. And everything that we do is that we're serving the public. We're serving our community. So what they did is that they did some checking, and they found out that, yes, we could be our own entity, but, yes, we could still also be a branch club of the Lions organization. So Ko'olaupoko took us in as their child. And so what happens by us becoming part of a lot, we are a Lions branch club, so we are Lions to the full extent. However, by being a branch club, our mother club, Ko'olaupoko, is responsible for all of the reporting, all the stuff that goes along with being part of an international group. We just feed them the information. They take care of it all. But we get all the benefits of being a Lions group. What that also does for that gives us an enormous working group of people that are able to help us. So in the very beginning, we had two new folks that joined. They were inducted into the Lions, or into our branch club. So the two ladies in red where I was holding the candle, those two ladies became Lion members for our branch club. And so when we saw all these other folks with the fellow with a mustache and everything, he's with Ko'olaupoko. But what they do is that they provide us with a lot of volunteers. So that's how we kind of maintain being able to provide the services that we do, is through the volunteerism of the Lions organization. And then what we do is that we, as Manawalea, we go out and we help them with the Great Aloha Run. We go help them. We host the blind picnic for them. And we do just a lot of things. So it's a really, really nice marriage.